Well, it looks like Rachel Maddow got punked, but here is the report that Rachel Maddow intended to give on April 22 on her show. It was a breakdown of the federal court hearing held at Beth Israel Deaconess Hospital with 19-year-old defendant Dzhokhar Tsarnaev.
Today at Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center in Boston, a federal court hearing was called to order in the hospital room. A federal magistrate judge came to the hospital along with the defense attorney and the prosecutor, and late this afternoon they released a transcript of the court hearing conducted right next to Dzhokhar Tsarnaev's hospital bed at Beth Israel. Judge, I will ask the doctor whether or not the patient is alert. You can rouse him. And the doctor says to the patient, how are you feeling? Are you able to answer some questions? The defendant nods affirmatively. Then the clerk of the court says, United States District Court for the District of Massachusetts is now in session. The Honorable Marianne B. Bowler presiding. The case of U.S. versus Tsarnaev will now be heard. Will counsel please identify themselves for the record? Then the defense counsel and the prosecuting counsel identify themselves. They say, good morning, Your Honor. The judge then asks the defense counsel, you have had an opportunity to speak with your client? And the answer is very briefly, Your Honor. Then the judge says to the patient slash defendant, so you have your lawyers here. The defendant nods affirmatively. Then it's the judge. Mr. Tsarnaev, I am Magistrate Judge Bowler. This hearing is your initial appearance before the court. We are here because you have been charged in a federal criminal complaint. At this hearing, I will advise you of your constitutional and legal rights. I will tell you about the charges against you and the penalties that the court could impose if you are found guilty. You have been charged with one, use of a weapon of mass destruction, and malicious destruction of property resulting in death. The judge asks the prosecuting attorney, Mr. Weinreb, what are the maximum penalties? And the prosecutor tells her, death or imprisonment for life or imprisonment for any term of years. And it's the judge again speaking to the defendant. This is not a trial and you will not be called upon to answer the charges at this time. If at any time I say something you do not understand, interrupt me and say so. Is that clear? The defendant nods affirmatively. The judge, all right, I note that the defendant has nodded affirmatively. As a first step in this hearing, I'm going to tell you about your constitutional rights. You have the right under the Constitution of the United States to remain silent. Any statement made by you may be used against you in court, and you have the right not to have your own words used against you. You may consult with an attorney prior to any questioning, and you may have the attorney present during the questioning. Counsel will be appointed without charge if you cannot afford counsel. If you choose to make a statement or to answer questions without the assistance of counsel, you may stop answering at any time. This right means you do not have to answer any questions put to you by law enforcement agents or by the assistant U.S. attorney, Mr. Weinreb. The judge then says, I want to make it clear. You are not prohibited from making statements, but that if you do, they can be used against you. You are not required to make a statement at this initial appearance, and any statement you do make may be used against you. Finally, if I ask you any questions here in this hearing or at any future hearing which you think might incriminate you, you have the right not to answer. Do you understand everything I have said about the right to remain silent? The defendant nods affirmatively. The judge says, as you have the right to have this court assigned counsel if you cannot afford counsel or if you cannot obtain counsel. Can you afford a lawyer? The defendant says no. And this is the first time we know that he can speak, because he does speak. He says just that one word. And apparently he says it with difficulty, because the judge responds by saying, let the record reflect that I believe the defendant has said no. I have provisionally appointed the federal defender to represent you in this matter. And the prosecuting attorney asks for the young man to be detained pending trial. Given that he's in a hospital bed and can't much move, the defense attorney says effectively, yes, that's no problem with us. We voluntarily agree to that. And then they all agree that the defense lawyers can have access to their client pursuant to hospital regulations and that sort of thing. And then they agree that the next hearing will be May 30th, which is 5.5 weeks from now, at 10 in the morning. And then proceedings are adjourned at the hospital bed. That's the way we do it in this country. Even if justice has to travel to you in your hospital bed as you recover from gunshot wounds to the head and the neck and the legs and the hand, the judge will come to you and the prosecutor, and you will get read your rights, and you will be assigned a defense attorney if you cannot afford one, and you will be tried in court, in civilian court.
So this is the segment that Rachel had prepared to report having to do with the federal court hearing. She shows you each page, a screenshot of each page of the transcript, and the proceedings. Nowhere in the proceedings, you'll notice, did the defendant admit to any crime at the advice of his attorney. This was not that kind of hearing. Now here's where Rachel got punked. At the beginning of her show, she was handed a script to read that was breaking news. And this is what poisoned the well on her prepared report. Now listen to this. An unsubstantiated report about how the defendant admitted guilt. Now, if you heard this before you heard Rachel's prepared report, you would think that both things happened during the federal hearing, but that's not the case at all. This report originated from an unnamed senior government official, not Pete Williams. Although Pete Williams' name is mentioned for credibility, it's an unnamed senior government official that reports that the defendant admitted to the crime. That's how corporate media works. Deception. Okay, so here's what Rachel was handed to read before she gave a report. This is what people heard first. Here it is.
I actually have some breaking news to give you right now. This is brand new from NBC News' Pete Williams. Several officials familiar with the initial interrogation of Dzhokhar Tsarnaev at the hospital in Boston describe him as cooperative. A senior government official tells NBC News that Tsarnaev has told them by writing some answers and by nodding yes or shaking his head no to others that he and his brother were not in touch with any overseas terrorists or groups, and that they conceived the bombing attack on their own, motivated, he told them, by religious fervor. They got their instructions on how to make bombs from the internet, he said, according to these officials. Again, that is breaking news from just moments ago from Pete Williams at NBC News. We'll give you more on that as we learn it.
So this is an obvious act of desperation. Anonymous government officials using Pete Williams' name as credibility to relay information that never was recorded in the official record. Never. It'll be interesting to see how the defense attorney reacts to the news that his client has already admitted to the crime.